Hey, have you got a minute? Have you got an hour? Have you got a day? Have you got a month? You know what? We really don't know, do we? Oh, we assume that we have more life, but quite honestly, kind of sad, kind of sobering. I met with a man just last week. We had a conversation after service. Now, he told me about who he was, what he was doing with his life. Do you know that within 1 week, he died in his sleep? Now, he had no idea at the time, nor did I, that he'd only have one more week to live. And that's not to scare you. No, it's to stir you. We're supposed to number our days. That's what Psalm 90 says. To make the most, yes, and to gain wisdom. How do we do the dash? Well, that's what this study's all about. I hope you stick around for it, and I'll see you at the very end of the study for a short commentary and an opportunity for all of us to really get engaged, making the most of every day. I'll see you then. Everyone's got a dash. A dash, it's that small horizontal line that appears under your name and after your birth date. That dash, well, that's waiting for another date. Yeah. Soon there'll be a date of death. It will follow the dash. The dash follows your date of birth. Obviously, the question that's often asked, what did you do with your dash? Your life. Quite honestly, if you live your life to the fullest, well, then you've had that happy life. And it's in light of that fact, Solomon, well, he has something to say. And I believe that with what he says, at least the first half of chapter 7, we would know how better to make the most of our dash. Ecclesiastes 7:1, we read, a good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. Better to go to the house of mourning than go to the house of feasting, for that's the end of all men, and the living will take it to heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by a sad countenance the heart is made better. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of mirth. It's better to hear the rebuke of a wise than for a man to hear the song of fools. For like the crackling of thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of the fool. This also is vanity. It's the first of four. How do you make the most of your dash? If you're a note taker, realize, remember, number one, eternity is longer than now. Now you say, well, that's something I don't know I need to write down. No. Think about it. How many decisions are made in the now only to discover that because it was so immediate, it was so instantaneous, there wasn't any real wisdom attached to that decision. And after the fact, you end up regretting it. You see, the very first verse of Ecclesiastes 7 is a reminder that honor is more valuable than perfume. Why? Because perfume is a matter of vanity. Perfume is a matter of something that's there, that something just, well, it faded away. And the problem lies in the fact that we don't recognize that as fleeting as the fragrance of cologne or perfume is as fleeting as your life. Your life. It's more than noteworthy. Keep your place in Ecclesiastes 7. It's James chapter 4. And in James chapter 4, drawing your attention to verse 13, if you have a highlighter, you want to underline this. Come now, you who say, tomorrow or today, we will go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell and make a profit, whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then it vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. What did we read? He says your life is a vapor. Circle the word for vapor. In another translation, he says your life is but a mist, M-I-S-T, mist. Another translation says your life is like the morning dew. There's a dew point. You see it on the lawn. But by the afternoon sun, it's gone. He says your life's very much the same way. Now, if your life is that fleeting, if your life is that passing, if it's only there just for a moment in time, contrast or to compare that to all eternity. And if eternity is forever and now is just, well, it's just not that long. I don't say those things to scare you. I say those things to stir you. We assume way too much on the compassion and kindness and grace and mercy of God. So if you did have just 1 week to live, how differently would you live it? Well, why don't you do that now? Well, I don't know if I want to do that right now. Well, because you're assuming that you've got more time. No, don't do that. Don't do that. Why? You may not make the decisions that would be the better decisions in light of the fact that you don't have that much time. What would some of those decisions be? Well, the contrast is clear in the text. If you didn't think in terms of your death being imminent, you'd probably go to a feast rather than go to a funeral. You'd probably like some laughs more than you'd like to cry. You'd probably like to do some foolish things rather than do wise things. And you probably like songs more than you like a rebuke. He lists them all. And when I paraphrase it in that way and run them through the line, obviously most of us would say, okay, I got a choice. I can either go to a backyard barbecue, flip some burgers, laugh with a few of my friends, or I can go to a memorial service for a friend. Which do I want to do? Well, obviously most of us rather feast than a funeral. He says, herein lies the problem. The feast is going to come and go. Feasting times come and go all the time. He said, not too much thought at the backyard barbecue. He said, but if instead you find yourself in a memorial service, he said, you're going to be thinking some deeper thoughts. You're going to think about what matters most in life. And you're going to be thinking about your own eternity. And for that reason, you start thinking about your own life. You think about your own immortality. You start thinking about your own legacy, you start thinking about all these things he's listed us to think about. Now, the life that's lived as unto the Lord, I want you to consider this fact and let's adjust our thinking. Jot it down, Philippians 1, 21 through 23. The Apostle Paul says to be absent in the body is to be present with Christ. So he tells us that death is actually gain. Psalm 116, verse 15 says, precious in the eyes of the Lord are the death of his children, his saints. Those two verses help emphasize the fact that when Solomon says, hey, your date of death is better than your date of birth, that we sometimes have the whole understanding of it completely in reverse. You got earth, you got the kingdom, and then we're stuck in the middle. The Apostle Paul said, you know, I don't know what to do. He goes, I want to stay here and I want to do stuff for you guys. At the same time, I want to be in heaven with the Lord. And he was burdened at the point of knowing that staying meant more reward in the kingdom to come, and leave and met and join his reward, but he still wanted more people to know the Lord. He found himself somewhere in the middle, like to die or not to die, you know? He just found himself right there. But then, no. To die is gain. When I leave this body, I'll be present with the Lord. And you know, I can't wait to see my Savior's face. I hope you feel the same. So he, the writer, Solomon, he knows there is so much more. He says, guys, there's more. But the more in store has everything to do with how you do your dash. So don't just think, hey, if I smell good, I'm there. No, he says, could you be good instead of just smell good? Could you recognize that there are some experiences in life that as you course them, it may be better for you to have a really good cry than a really good laugh? It might be wiser for you to say, you know what? I'm going to go to that friend's memorial service and I'm going to be there as a tool in the hand of God. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to be very, very wise. You know, I got some silly friends. Here's what I'm going to do instead. I'm going to, even to the point where he determines it's better to be rebuked than hear the song of a fool. Keep in mind, not everyone knows what you know. So here you are knowing it. Whether or not you're growing with what you're knowing is a matter of what you do with the dash. Make the most of your dash. What else does he say? Back with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 7. Pick it up this time. In verse 7 we read, surely oppression destroys a wise man's reason, and a bribe debases the heart. The end of a thing is better than its beginning. The patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. Do not hasten in your spirit to be angry, for anger rests in the bosom of a fool. And do not say, why were the former days better than these? For you do not inquire wisely concerning this. Wisdom is good with an inheritance, and profitable to those who see the sun. For wisdom is a defense as money is a defense, but the excellence of knowledge is that wisdom gives life to those who have it. Pause right there, your attention, please. If you're a note taker, jot it down this way. Fools will fail before the faithful. And the reason I say it that way is there's a tendency for us to look on at the faithful, the good guy, the Bible guy, you know, the Christian. And we tend to think that some of the decisions they're making, well, I have more freedom in my life. I'm a little more liberal than that. I can actually let down my hair. I can have a good time. And that's what the fool says to the faithful. But the faithful needs to look on at the fool and say, I'm sorry, if you're not faith-filled, then the simple things in life that become complex, and the complex things in life that create a desperate situation, well, you know, it's been said that desperate times call for desperate measures. Desperate times call for desperate measures. Look at verse 7 again of chapter 7. Surely oppression destroys a wise man's reason, and a bribe debases the heart. What's he saying? There's a tendency for desperate times to create desperate decisions that are matched by desperate measures. But if you're a believer, I'm sorry, what's so desperate? And Solomon says, you can't take what anymore? How bad is it? Can I share something with you? The end of a thing is better than its beginning. That's not a marriage verse. There's some guy going, I found a verse, babe. No. No, it's much deeper than that. What's that? Moving away from the lightheartedness. When you grab hold of that verse, you realize God's trying to say something to you about his economy, about his ability, about his desire, about his will, and how you can be in a situation right now and say, I can't take this anymore. I can't do this anymore. He said, do you actually think it's going to get that much worse, or do you think there's a possibility in my economy for things to actually get better than worse? The end of the thing is better than the beginning. How can the end be better? Because if you let God into the bad thing, it's not going to get worse. It will get better. God says, could you trust me on that? Or instead, are you going to see this thing as, of course it's going to get worse. Of course God's not going to show up. Of course I can't continue. Of course I have to quit. What are you doing? Do you not know who God is? Guys, come here a minute. Is there something you're trying to get out of right now? Is there something you're tired about? I can't take it anymore. Take what? What is really the issue? What is the real problem? What is the thing that you're really bothered about? And why are you so angry? See, what happens, we get angry, we shake our fist at God, go, God, I don't know why. And God's saying, and I can see him looking at us. You have no idea, do you? Somebody needs that verse right here, right now. And that's your verse. And that's the one that you now say, I'm going to take that verse, I'm going to stop complaining about how good it used to be, and you know what? I'm going to start making tomorrow my better days. Why? Because God is faithful. He can do it. You have to believe it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Let him be God. You got to let him be God. But let me tell you where that starts. That starts with being faith-filled. That starts with saying, God, fill me. That starts with you saying, I want to get in the Word. You got to let this book talk to you. This book so talks. It talks. He's waiting to talk to you. He does it with these verses. Back to Ecclesiastes. This time, chapter 7 and verse 13, for consider the work of God, who can make straight what he's made crooked. In the day of prosperity, be joyful, but in the day of adversity, consider God has appointed the one as well as the other so that man can find out nothing that will come after him. What's he saying? Well, if you're a note taker, jot it down this way. Wisdom accepts what the fool rejects. Happens all the time. Why? The wise one has got a stability within his heart. The Spirit does that to him. And because there's a stability in his heart, he doesn't go up and down, so high, so low, because just the waves of the world are crashing. No, his life is built upon the rock, not shifting sand. So if his life is on the rock, what happens? He stands strong. He goes, I'm okay right now. I know the waves are rising. I know the wind is blowing. I know the rain is beating. But I built my house on the rock. The guy in the shifting sand, well, here's what happens. He doesn't recognize that there are some things he just can't change and to live with it. He says, listen, if God makes something crooked and he's determined it's going to be crooked, why are you bothered? You can't make it straight. I have come to realize that I can only change the things I can change. That's pretty profound. No, but how many people are bothered about something they can't do anything about? But what happens in our life is that he says, sometimes you have this day of blessedness, prosperity, and joy. Other days you have adversity and trial and difficulty. The wise man, what you realize, you had a bad day. That's what you had. You had a bad day. You're taking one down. You sing a sad song just to turn it around. You say you don't know. You tell me don't lie. You work at a smile. And then you go for a ride. You had a bad day. The camera don't lie. You're coming back down. You really don't mind. You had a bad day. Here's the deal. I didn't do that well. But how many people have a bad day and it turns into a bad week? Because you're so down because you would not believe what happened. And now, stop. Stop. Get a grip. What's that all about? That's all about an embarrassment. That's you needing to look at your face in the mirror when you're whining and then asking yourself with your own mouth, what's the problem? What I'm trying to say to you is this. If God has allowed something to happen, if he's the author, it's your reaction or it's your response that in many ways is the one thing you actually have power over. So God's saying, this is going to happen. You're going, I can't believe it. Stop. You're a Christian. If God's the author, could he not make an adjustment in you? And you stand out like a really bright light and you flavor your world with a different taste because you're the Christian? Why is it that Christians sometimes seem to be the quickest whiners?
because I'm a king's kid and I just expected that.
But sometimes it's a matter of your heart, not a matter of the circumstance or the difficulty or the trial, the problem. Now, this is very easy for me to say with my mouth. Whether I believe it in my heart is up to my own opportunity when I face a trial. But this is a reality. Back to Ephesians 7. Here's where we close it in verse 15. I have seen everything in my days of vanity. There's a just man who perishes in his righteousness. There's a wicked man who prolongs life in his wickedness. So don't be overtly righteous and don't be overtly wise. Why should you destroy yourself? Do not be overly wicked nor be foolish. Why should you die before your time? It is good that you grasp this and also not remove your hand from another, for he who fears God will escape them all. Now, the commentary on this section of scripture sends the scholars somewhat scattered because even though we know he's kind of been on a roll saying some pretty profound and provocative things, suddenly it's like he slips. It's like, well, what did you just say? Don't be overtly righteous and don't be overly wise. So most will submit that what he's saying is don't be overtly self-righteous. Don't be overtly wise in your own eyes. Why? Because the context of the counsel has more to do with the totality of God's word. And in the totality of God's word, the only thing that would be judged that way would be self-righteousness, not righteousness, because a righteous man, there's promises given. Now, on the flip side, I will say, when he says there's a just man who perishes in his righteousness and there's a wicked man who prolongs his life in his wickedness, that's Cain and Abel. Easy commentary, easy illustration. One's righteous, he dies in his righteousness. One's wicked, and he lives longer than his dead brother. You go, that makes no sense to me at all. No. Of course it makes no sense to you, Solomon. You're still on this side of heaven. My fourth and final point is this. Good behavior gets rewards and bad behavior gets punishment. The problem, my friend, is that sometimes if somebody doesn't get punished here and now, or somebody doesn't get rewarded here and now, we think that they missed the punishment. We think they missed the reward. That's not true. Good behavior still gets rewards. It just may not get it here. Bad behavior still gets punishment. It may not get it here. But the reality of who God is with his word is a matter of what the scriptures have to say about judgment and about righteousness and this simple fact that God is a just and merciful judge. He's the best judge. And if you want to check it out for homework, it's Luke chapter 8, 16 through 18. Listen to the way that this reads. He says, "For nothing is secret that will not be revealed, nor anything hidden that will not be known and come to life. Therefore, take heed how you hear. For whoever has, to him more will be given, and whoever does not have, even what seems to have will be taken from him." It's as if God has a way of saying, if you think you can, you really can't. And if you don't, no, it's the best thing to do. If in fact it's linked to my word, and there is an attitude of righteous morality. But don't think for a moment that in that pendulum of extremes, you've made a mistake if you move to the righteous side, even if you don't get your righteous reward while you're here. And that's why that conclusive reference again reads this way. "It is good you grasp this and also not remove your hand from another, for he who fears God will escape them all." Escape what all? Escape all other fears. Escape all other worries. If you put God first, what happens? Well, in your fear of God, all of those other worries, all those concerns, all of those, I'm concerned about what man thinks. I'm concerned about what my boss will think. I'm concerned about what my girlfriend will think. You know what? Concern yourself with what God thinks. And if you concern yourself with what God thinks, let the chips fall where they may. You will not regret putting God first in your decisions and in your direction. Amen? So now you know what to do with the dash. And now my curiosity, when do you start?
When do you actually start living life so that the day you die, you will look back at your past and say, I made the most of every moment? Hey, there's a number on the screen. There's a web address. We'd love to help you. We got plenty of resources and the chance for you to engage in. A necessary next step would be a simple prayer, asking Jesus to come into your heart. Because once he does, he'll give you all the help necessary to continue to stay the course and go that direction, yeah, his direction, until you see his face. Between now and the next time, I'm certainly glad you joined us. I'm Bob Coy. God bless you.
Call Active Word now for your copy of Pastor Bob's sermon notes so you can dig deeper into the thoughts and ideas behind this message. The notes are laid out in an engaging style designed to enrich your personal devotion.
There's nothing like an open road. Some of us are just too proud to use maps and just try to figure it out on our own. We may take a few wrong turns, and sometimes we don't quite make it. Here's a story about a man who saw life as an open road, taking everything the world had to offer, driving in the fast lane and seeing it was taking him nowhere. Until he found a crossroad. It's a story of one almost surrendered life. In this book, Bob Coy invites you to explore his journey. Take a road trip of discovery where you'll find not only what God can do with an ordinary man's life, but also what God can do in yours. Call the Active Word now for your copy of One Almost Surrendered Life for your gift of any amount.
The vision of Pastor Bob Coy and the ministry team at the Active Word is to strengthen your relationship with Jesus Christ by helping you make His Word an active part of your daily life. That's why we've created a library of resources that will take your life to a new level. Just visit us at activeword.org to find online devotionals, books, CDs, DVDs, and more. And please consider supporting this great effort financially, because every dollar is used to share the life-changing message of the gospel with the world. Just call us at 877-888-WORD. That's 877-888-9673. Or you can give online at activeword.org. And if you're in the South Florida area, we'd love you to join us at Calvary Chapel, Fort Lauderdale. It's a remarkable family of faith and friendship. And all we're missing is you. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week.
I know a lot of smart people.
You've just seen The Active Word with Pastor Bob Coy on TV. Now get it to go and take it with you. Search for The Active Word in iTunes and connect to all of our media, the TV program, daily radio podcast, and on-the-go Devo. It's all free to download for your mobile device. Subscribe to the podcast and you won't miss a moment of Pastor Bob's messages, all designed to keep you in step with God's Word. And once you're subscribed, follow us on Twitter and Facebook for the latest Active Word news and Pastor Bob's video blogs, where you can join the conversation on current events and topics and submit your own question for Pastor Bob.
I've got a subscriber question. It reads this way: how or can a Christian have ambition for the future while keeping content in his or her current circumstance?
iTunes, Facebook, and Twitter. It's how you can take the Active Word from the pulpit to your pocket and with you wherever you go.